Hi everybody, my name is Andriy and welcome back to Med School EU. Today we are going to continue on with this lengthy topic of anatomy and physiology of systems in humans. And more specifically today, we are going to talk about the respiratory system. We'll begin the unit with anatomy of the respiratory system. So we have a couple of labels to go through, just anatomical labels here. So beginning with the upper respiratory tract, we got the nasal cavity up at the top. So this is the nasal cavity. Next, this little part right here at the back of the throat, that's called the pharynx. That's pharynx. Going a little bit lower past the pharynx, we got the larynx, and in the larynx, we've got our vocal cords. So this is where the sound comes from. That comes from the vocal cords in the larynx. Now going further down, there's going to be a divide here between the upper respiratory tract and the lower respiratory tract. So these, all of these anatomical structures are part of the upper respiratory tract. And going below down here to the trachea, so this is the trachea. And anything below the trachea is the lower respiratory tract. So splitting off from the trachea to the right lung and the left lung, this big part right here is called the primary bronchi. And past the bronchi, of course, we've got here the lungs. And we're going to go into further anatomy about the lungs, because there's going to be further breakdowns and splitting of these tubes from the bronchi all the way down to the alveoli. And that's what we are going to discuss in this one. So here, of course, we got our trachea. As you can see, it's covered in cartilage. And the next is the bronchi, which we have labeled already. As you can see, they're pretty much identical on both sides. Then this moves into terminal bronchial. So that's the smaller division here from the bronchus. It becomes a terminal bronchial. And from terminal bronchial, we go into respiratory bronchial. And finally, this goes into the alveolar duct. And from the alveolar duct, we're going to have these little grape-like structures called alveoli. And gas exchange occurs in the alveoli and sporadically in the alveolar duct. However, all these other structures, the bronchioles, respiratory, terminal, and bronchi, the bronchus, and the trachea, there's going to be no gas exchange occurring. Only the alveoli and sometimes alveolar duct, depending on the thickness of it. Now, the structure that goes right underneath, it is not shown here, but the structure that goes underneath the lungs is called the diaphragm. And the diaphragm is responsible for contraction of the lungs. So it's going to stimulate breathing, as well as the intercostal muscles. So the muscles that go in between here are called intercostal muscles, the one that go between the ribs and the diaphragm at the bottom, are going to be responsible for inflating and deflating the lungs. And we're going to discuss their primary functions in the next few slides as well. So there are three more labels here. So we got the pleural cavity. So there's going to be a space between the two pleural. So the outer pleura is called the parietal. The inner pleura is called the visceral pleura. And of course, the space in between is going to be called pleural cavity. So this is just a cavity space in between the two pleura. So that's the general respiratory system anatomy. So now we are going to talk a little bit about gas exchange as it occurs in the alveoli. So for breathing in, the gas is primarily going to be oxygen. And the gas pressure here in the capillary is primarily going to be carbon dioxide. So we're going to offload the carbon dioxide and we're going to load on the oxygen. And the reason that's going to happen is because of partial gas pressures. So the partial gas pressure of oxygen in the alveoli is going to be much greater than in the capillary. Therefore, the net movement of gas is going to go to the capillary. And this is just a phenomenon called diffusion, where it goes from an area of high concentration to an area of lower concentration. In this case, we're talking about gases, therefore, we're going to refer to it as partial pressure. So, higher partial pressure of gas is going to move over to the lower partial pressure of gas. Now, the same thing occurs with the carbon dioxide. The atmospheric carbon dioxide partial pressure is extremely low compared to the capillary carbon dioxide partial pressure because these capillaries are going to bring deoxygenated blood from the body and which will have metabolites and carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide is going to be taken up by the alveoli again through diffusion, the same concept, where it goes from an area of higher partial pressure to an area of lower partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Now, the exact opposite occurs once these travel to cells. So these are not alveoli anymore, these are just cells of the body. Now, cells of the body are going to have lots of carbon dioxide in high concentrations. So there's going to be high partial pressure of carbon dioxide, but they're going to have low oxygen. So the whole purpose of the circulatory system is to deliver nutrients and oxygen to the cells so they can operate and do their primary functions. So once the blood vessels are able to circulate from the lungs over to the cells, again, they're going to go through the heart and then the entire respiratory system. They're going to end up in various cells of the body. And they're going to offload their high partial pressure of oxygen onto the cells because they're going to have low partial pressure of oxygen. And they're going to uptake the high partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Again, the same concept that occurs through diffusion. Now, before we take a look at this chart right here, there's another phenomenon I wanted to mention is that the right lung, the right lobe of the lung contains three lobes, and the left side, so the left lung, contains two lobes. So it's a little bit smaller. It doesn't split up into as many lobes. The right lung has three, the left lung has two. So that's another thing to just keep in mind. And here with this chart, we are going to discuss various structures that are involved within each of these anatomical positions that we discussed earlier. So the trachea, number of trachea, there's only one trachea that splits off into two bronchi. So for each side of the lung, or each bronchus, I should say, is going to split off into thousands, 48,000 of terminal bronchioles. And something very important happens here is that the trachea and the bronchus have cartilage. They're going to have cartilage in their structures in order to support that volume and the air that's coming in. So they're going to have cartilage there. They're also going to have goblet cells that will produce mucus, and they're going to be responsible to keep out any viruses or any bacteria that may enter the respiratory system. They're going to keep out the flu, the cold. As we get in contact with the flu virus, the coronaviruses, and just the regular respiratory viruses that we get in the winter, they are going to be caught up by these goblet cells and the cilia. So goblet cells and cilia, they're responsible for creating mucus where all of these respiratory illnesses and all of these viruses are going to be caught up, and the cilia, so these are little projections, the cilia are going to be pushing up up the wall down to the trachea and in reverse, so that you can just cough it out or breathe it out without the virus attaching to receptors inside the lungs and causing an illness. Now, another thing to note is the trachea, the bronchus, and the terminal bronchial have smooth muscle. So this means they could dilate, they could stretch a little bit, which involves the elastic tissue as well. So up to the point of the terminal bronchial, they are going to have smooth muscle, which could control how wide the airway is going to be. So for example, if you are out in a colder environment, the smooth muscle is typically going to contract a little bit to create resistance for the air. So the air is not going to pass as quickly, and you are not going to get cold air entering the alveoli, because that obviously could cause problems for the alveolar cells. Therefore, in order to buffer that temperature of the air, you're going to have smooth muscle that are going to contract, and they're going to reduce the diameter of the trachea and the bronchus. And something very similar happens with anaphylactic shock or an allergic reaction, where the trachea and the bronchus, the smooth muscles there, are going to contract, and they're going to make a narrow airway, and that's when problems occur with breathing and anaphylactic shock. So as you can see here, as I mentioned previously, the site of gas exchange, so the exchange that occurs here and here in terms of the carbon dioxide and the oxygen, only occurs in alveoli and the alveolar duct. Primarily in the alveoli, however, in some cases alveolar duct as well. There's going to be no gas exchange in any of the bronchioles or the bronchus or the trachea. Important thing to remember is that trachea and bronchus have goblet cells that produce mucus. Smooth muscle and cilia are going to be all the way down to the terminal bronchial, but not the respiratory bronchioles. And cartilage will only reside with the trachea and the bronchus. So when we discuss the immune response, we are going to talk about the goblet cells and the smooth muscle cells in greater detail. Next, we have a quick slide about the gas content of the blood. So you should be familiar with how carbon dioxide is going to be transported within the blood, because for oxygen, of course, it's going to be loaded onto hemoglobin, and then hemoglobin is going to be carrying 4 oxygen molecules per 1 molecule of hemoglobin, and there's going to be millions of molecules of hemoglobin within each erythrocyte. So that's typically how oxygen is going to be carried within the red blood cell. However, when we have carbon dioxide inside circulatory system, we're going to have a bit of a different story. So first, from the respiring cells, so from our cells, we're going to get carbon dioxide that will enter the erythrocyte. 5% of carbon dioxide will be carried in solution, meaning it's going to be carried in the plasma. Now, the rest, the highlighted areas is what's going to be important, because the carbon dioxide is going to combine with water in some cases using an enzyme called carbonic anhydrase, and it's going to create a molecule of hydrogen carbonate. So most of carbon dioxide is going to be transported as hydrogen carbonate, which is this molecule right here, HCO3. Minus 85% of the carbon dioxide will go there, and 10% of the carbon dioxide will be converted to carbaminohemoglobin, which is simply when carbon dioxide combines with the hemoglobin within the erythrocyte. So only about 10% will be carried the same as oxygen. However, the rest of the carbon dioxide, most of it, will be carried in the plasma as hydrogen carbonate. So now we're going to talk about the physiology of respirations, and we're going to begin with inspiration, which is going to be inhaling, so getting oxygen and air into our lungs. So we are gonna first make a couple of labels here. So of course we got the diaphragm. Now this yellow structure right here, this is more gonna be like a zoom in of an alveoli. So I'm just gonna label it as alveolar pressure, P alveolar. So the gas pressure in the alveoli. Then the gas pressure that's going to be within the lung is called intrapulmonary pressure. Inside the pleural cavity, we are going to have intrapleural pressure. Now, the pressure difference between the intrapleural pressure and the pressure inside the lung is called transpulmonary pressure. So these are all the important, and also we got atmospheric, so PATM, atmospheric pressure. So all of these are going to be involved in the breathing anatomy and the physiology of breathing. Now, of course, we have intercostal muscles that go around the side of the lungs, and that's going to be the ones in between the ribs. So let's go over some of the sequences of events that occur. So we first are going to begin with the inspiratory muscles that are going to contract, and that's going to be the diaphragm. So the diaphragm, the intercostal muscles are going to make the rib cage to push outward and up. So the rib, this is how we are going to create more volume within the lungs. So we must remember that volume and pressure are inversely related. So if we increase the volume, we are gonna decrease the pressure. If we increase the pressure, we're gonna decrease the volume. So what this does, what this first sequence does, is it increases volume because we are gonna expand the lungs. And when we increase volume, we are gonna decrease the pressure. And we're gonna decrease the pressure to the point where the atmospheric pressure is going to be above the pressure inside the lungs and ultimately the pressure inside the alveoli. Therefore, the air can simply flow through the diffusion from the atmosphere inside the lung and into the alveoli because it's going to move from, by the definition of diffusion, it's going to move from the higher partial pressure of gas to lower partial pressure of gas. So what this really does, the ultimate thing is that the intrapleural pressure, PIP, is going to decrease because our lung volume has increased. So now, because this has decreased, number three, the P atmospheric is going to be above PIP. And we have air flows inside. So that's typically how it occurs because as the gases flow into the lungs down its pressure gradient until that intrapulmonary pressure is zero. So then by the end of it, once we fully have inhaled, the atmospheric pressure is going to equal to intrapulmonary pressure. Because, of course, the more air we get inside, the more pressure it's going to create. And eventually, it's going to equate itself with the atmospheric pressure, and you can no longer breathe any further. You cannot breathe in any further. You cannot take up more air. Now, with expiration, so breathing out, we're going to have something pretty much the opposite occur. So we're going to have the inspiratory muscles relax, so the diaphragm. And this is all due to the recoil of the costal cartilages. So if you stretch the cartilage of the rib cage, it's obviously going to want to recoil back because it's got its elastic fibers. And the elastic fibers will naturally want to recoil back to its original form. So that's going to create that pressure, that tension that is going to counteract the pressure that is created by the diaphragm rising and the intercostal muscles contracting. Next, we're going to have the thoracic volume or the thoracic cavity volume decrease. meaning that it's going to increase the pressure. And as soon as the PIP pressure is above the atmospheric pressure, then obviously the air is going to flow out into the atmosphere because it's going to move from higher pressure to lower pressure environment. And again, it's going to occur until finally the PIP, the intrapleural pressure, is going to equate to atmospheric pressure, and you can no longer breathe out any further. And the final thing that I'm going to introduce you to is called a spirogram. So this is basically just a measurement of lung volumes and lung capacities. So what we have here is the general breathing rate. If we are just breathing at a resting rate, you're sitting down on your chair, you're listening to this lecture, your breathing is going to be the tidal volume. It's only going to be about maybe 500 milliliters of gas that's going to come in and out, and that's going to be labeled as tidal volume. Now, the entire capacity of the lungs, so how much air we could possibly have inside the lungs if you fully breathe in and all the air that was already in there, that's going to be called the total lung capacity. Now, there's something called residual volume, and residual volume is something you cannot breathe out. Of course, if you were to breathe out all the air that's inside your lung, your lung is going to collapse in on itself. So there's always going to be some sort of a little bit of air, and that's typically you see 1200 milliliters of air inside the lungs that is constantly there. Even if you forcefully expire, you're still going to have that residual volume there, and you cannot get rid of it unless you puncture the lung and it flows out. And at that point, you're going to have a collapsed lung. And of course, that's going to create lots of problems. So that's the residual volume. It's extremely important for our vital functions. Now, the volume that you could breathe out, and in addition with the residual volume, is called functional residual capacity. So that's the expiratory reserve volume plus the residual volume. So both of these together. An expiratory reserve volume is how much air you could forcefully breathe out. So if you're regularly breathing right now and watching this lecture, try to breathe out as much as you can to the point where you can no longer breathe out anything else. That's your expiratory reserve volume. From the point of breathing out normally to the point of fully forcefully breathing out, that's the expiratory reserve volume. Now, if you add that together with the residual volume, that makes up functional residual capacity that is labeled here. Next, we're gonna look at the inspiratory reserve volume. So that's completely the opposite of the expiratory. Inspiratory reserve volume is when you are doing your tidal volume, you're normally breathing, and you normally breathe in. However, the rest that you can breathe in up to your full potential of breathing in, that's gonna be the inspiratory reserve volume. Now, if you combine the expiratory reserve volume plus tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume, so if you were to fully breathe in and then fully breathe out, that's your vital capacity. That's what's called vital capacity. So all of these three different capacities and four different types of volumes, you should know by heart. So if they are identified on a question, you would not be struggling to know what the question is really talking about. So this concludes our lecture on the respiratory system. In the next video, we are going to discuss the diseases involved with the circulatory system as well as the respiratory system.